He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, I wanted to go over some more nomenclature stuff with you, specifically dealing with some of these polycyclic structures that you might see, since we actually never really talked about how to name those. And instead of drawing them on the board, I wanted to use ChemDoodle, because there are some interesting features that allow you to sort of explore the nomenclature rules as you go. I'll show you what I mean. First, let's just do a quick review just to kind of get on the same page and do this simple alkane. So just to remember how we name these guys, we've got to find the longest carbon chain. So that is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We've got to have 6 carbons, right? That's going to be a hexane. So we can't look at this and go, all right, we got 5 and then an isopropyl. That's actually not going to work. So we do want to make sure we have this longest chain. And then we have to number starting from the side that will give the substituents occurring soonest. So we want to start here. This has got to be number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we've got methyls on 2 and 3. So just to make sure that we're right, let's go ahead and add that name. Okay, so we've got 2,3-dimethylhexane, like we said. So here's 1, and then 2 has a methyl, 3 has a methyl, 4, 5, 6. That's correct. Just to show you a feature here, this is fun. You can alter it as you go. So how many carbons do we have to attach here to make this side to side, this left to right chain, the longest chain? Well, okay, so what have we done here? Now it's still this, right? It's still 2 on the methyl, 3, we have an ethyl, 4, 5, 6. So that's still keeping the same parent chain that we had before. If we add one more, finally we've got this. This is now the parent chain, and this has become an isopropyl group instead of part of the main chain. So that's that one. That was just a quick warm-up, because now I want to get to the polycyclic stuff. We've already done that kind of stuff. So let's go over some new things that we have not discussed the nomenclature for. So let's take this. Let's put this over here. And this is called naphthalene. Okay, so when you have two benzene rings like this, they're fused at these two carbons. This is now called naphthalene. So what happens when we start attaching things here? Well, okay, so let's put a methyl over here. So 1-methyl naphthalene. Okay, so but let's look at something. This is why this is a cool feature. We can see what happens if we do different stuff instead of having to draw a bunch of structures for you. We can do this very quickly. So we see that this is also 1-methyl. What if I put it over here? This is also 1-methyl again. And lastly, this is also 1-methyl. And so what does that tell us? Well, these are all identical positions at first, because we can rotate that molecule, right? We can rotate it any way we want, and we're going to get the same thing. So that's why all those positions are identical. But let's say we put the 1 there. Where can we go? All right, well, what is this? So we've got 1, 2. So clearly, we're going to be numbering in this way. This looks like position 3. This will be position 4. Now, what about this? This cannot accommodate a bond. So we're actually not going to count these two carbons in the numbering scheme. So this will be position 5. This would be 1,5-dimethyl. This would be 1,6-dimethyl. This would be 1,7-dimethyl. And then lastly, this would be 1,8-dimethyl. Now, what if we start with something else? Let's put it over here. Now we've got 2-methyl. So that's counting this as carbon 1. So this has changed what we count as carbon 1. So let's take that and then let's add another one. Let's go over here. But now look at what happened. We did not keep this as carbon 1, as carbon 2, and this as carbon 1. Remember that we're going to number it so as to give the lowest set of locants to the substituents. So before, this was carbon 1 and this was carbon 2, and we had 2-methylnaphthalene. But if we put it over here, it's automatically going to count this carbon as carbon 1. Remember that any of these 4 could have been carbon 1. And if it does this, now we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 6 is lower than if we went 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's going to be a better numbering system for that. And we can just draw methyls everywhere and see what ends up happening. We can just look at the name. So clearly this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 tetramethyl instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we always want the lowest set of numbers, and specifically starting with the lowest number that you can. So that's naphthalene. Let's move on to another type of molecule. Let's do a biphenyl. So let's take this. Let's get the name. So there's our biphenyl. So this is different than naphthalene, right? Because they're not fused at two carbons. We're just connected by this single sigma bond here between these two rings. So that's biphenyl. Now let's start adding substituents. So, whoops, what if we do this? So now it says orthophenyltoluene. So by adding this substituent, we're changing the naming scheme because we're counting this whole part as toluene, right? Because toluene is a benzene ring with a methyl group on it. And there's a phenyl substituent, right? This is a phenyl substituent. And they are specifically, they have an ortho relationship to one another because they're one apart. We have a methyl right here, and we have a phenyl right here. They're one away, so that's an ortho relationship. So that's orthophenyltoluene. Now let's add another one and see what happens. So now we have 3-phenyl-ortho-xylene. So it seems that what's happening is that we're changing the parent name on the basis of the substituted phenyl and what that becomes. Because the thing is that a benzene ring with two methyls on it is called a xylene, right? So let's, just for reference, let's show this name. So that's toluene. And we can see that that's orthoxylene. That's metaxylene. And that's paraxylene. So clearly xylene is the name for a phenyl ring with a benzene ring with two methyl groups on it. And then we have ortho, meta, or para to describe their spatial relationship. So over here, we're taking this to be the main part of the molecule. We're saying that this is an orthoxylene. And then on orthoxylene, right, if these are the two right carbons with the methyls there, if we go 1, 2, 3, remember, lowest numbering scheme possible. So this would be 1, 2, 3. On carbon 3, we have a phenyl group. So that's 3-phenyl-orthoxylene. And we could have all kinds of fun with this. We could then come over here and start adding carbons over here and see what happens. So now 3-metatoluene. So this is now not 3-phenyl, but we're saying that it's a toluene because it's a toluene substituent. And it's on carbon 3. So this 3 refers to carbon 1, 2, 3. And then this meta refers to this meta relationship. This methyl is meta to this whole group over here. So it starts to get pretty complicated, but what's cool about this is you can just start putting carbons anywhere you want and see what happens to the name. And as you look at what changes with the name, you sort of learn the nomenclature rules. So that's a biphenyl. Let's look at something else. Now let's look at, we did naphthalene. So let's do, that was two rings put together. Now let's put 3-phenyl rings in this way. And let's get that name. And that's called anthracene. So naphthalene, two rings, three rings, we've got anthracene. And so how is this numbering scheme gonna go? Let's try one there. Okay, so that's 1-methyl anthracene. If we put that there, again, 1-methyl, there's 1-methyl, there's 1-methyl. Okay, so clearly we've got 4 options here for where number 1 is gonna go, and that makes sense because if we take that molecule and we rotate it 180 degrees like that in the plane, it would end up over here, so they'd better be the same spot. That makes perfect sense. So let's do number one. Okay, so which way are we going to go? Let's see what this position is. So that's clearly 2. So we have 1 and 2, because if we have 1,2-dimethyl, that's what it would be. Over there, we've got 3. Over there, we've got 4. Okay, so clearly we're going around the ring in this way. So should this be 5? Let's see if this is 5. No, it's not. That's 10. So what is 5 instead? If we go over here, okay, so if we continue in clockwise fashion to the other edgemost ring, outermost ring, now we've got 5. Now we've got 6 over there. Now we've got 7 over there. And we've got 8 over there. And then we go to these central carbons. If we continue in clockwise fashion, we've got 9 right there. And we've got 10 right there. So we have just sort of discovered the numbering scheme for anthracene. We know that we're going to define carbon 1, and then we're going to go around that ring. Whoops, we're going to go around that outermost ring, and then we're going to skip over to the other outermost ring and finish that off before we do the middle two. So we can throw some methyls on there. So this, if we put that there, we're defining this to be carbon 1 because that would make this 2, and that's the lowest that can be. And then let's put that over here. So that'd be 2, 10. So that's how we're going to number that. And we can just arbitrarily put a few on here and see what we get. 2, 7, 9. And we can just do examples all day and see what happens to the name there. Okay, so we've done some aromatic ones. Let's try some aliphatic ones. Let's try this. We're going to take a 3-membered ring here, and now let's attach a ring there. Actually, before I do that, let's name it. Okay, now let's attach a ring right here. So what is the scheme here? Clearly, we're going to use this word spiro here. And so we've got a cyclopropane, but we can't name this a cyclopropane substituent. It's not a cyclopropane substituent. We would need a sigma bond between them. So that's not the way we can go with this. Instead, we have to recognize that we're going to call it a pentane because it has 5 carbons. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But it's a spiro compound. And what these numbers mean is we're naming the number of carbons present in each ring apart from the one that joins them. So here's 2, and here's 2, and there's 5 total. So we say it's spiro. Spiro refers to this orientation. And then there's 2 carbons here, 2 carbons there, and there's 5 total, so it's a pentane. So what if we add a 4-membered or a 5-membered ring right there? So again, spiro, we're going to see spiro with all of these. And then now that we have 2 different sized rings, we're going to refer to the smaller one first. So here are 2 carbons. That's the 2 right there. And then here's 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's 4 carbons there. And so 4 plus 2 plus the one that joins them. Remember, there's always going to be one more because we're not considering this one that connects the 2 rings in this scheme, so add 1 to get 7, that's a heptane. Likewise, let's put 6. So again, it's pretty easy to see, it's pretty easy to know what to do. We've got a 3-membered ring, we don't count that one, so we've got 2. We've got a 6-membered ring, we don't count that one, so we've got 5. But then all together, the 5 plus the 2 plus the 1 that joins them, that's 8, so this is spiro 2,5-octane. If we want to start adding substituents, let's say like that, this is how we're going to number it. We've got to, everything is the same, but if we've added a methyl group, let's get rid of that. We're going to number from the smaller ring. So we've got 2 carbons here. This would be number 3 and then 4. So that's how we're going to number. We're not going to start numbering on the larger ring. We're going to start numbering from the smaller ring. Okay, let's do one more type of compound here. Let's do a 7-membered ring, and then let's get the name so we have it. So we've got cycloheptane. And now let's make a bridgehead carbon. Okay, so we've made a bicyclo structure. So the other one was spiro. Now we're looking at bicyclo. And the way that we're going to name these is, first we say it's bicyclo, and then we're going to it's kind of like the spiro. We're going to give the numbers of carbons associated with each ring. And so we're going to go from biggest to smallest. So over here we have 1, 2, 3. So that's your 3, 1, 2, 3. And then over here we have 2. And so that's the 2. And then right there we've got 1. So there's your 1. And total there are 8 carbons. Remember we had cycloheptane and then we added one more. So that's 8, that's octane. So this is bicyclo 3-2-1 octane. Now let's do something kind of cool because this looks confusing. What if we clean it up and do that? Okay, so that gives you a little bit of a better sense of what this molecule actually looks like. We can see how you can, there's a 5-membered ring over here. This is a 6-membered ring. This is a 7-membered, right? If you can just kind of see the different rings in this pseudo 3-dimensional way. Let's do 9. Why not? Okay, and then let's go like that. So what do you think this is going to be? It's going to be bicyclo. And then how are we going to number this? Remember, we've got the most first. So 1, 2, 3, 4. We need the 4. And then we've got 3. And then we've got 2. So we need 4, 3, 2. And then we refer to the total number. So that's an undecane. So, because we started with 9, we added 2 more for a total of 11, that's an undecane. And we have 4, 3, 2. And one more time, let's just make this look the way it should look. And that's what that looks like. So that's it. I just wanted to show you some fun ways to explore nomenclature rules for these trickier polycyclic compounds. Obviously, we could do this all day. There are many more types of molecules we could look at, but that's what I wanted to go over for now. Those are some common ones with naphthalene and anthracene and the spiro compounds and the bicyclo compounds. So I'll see you next time.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.